they sang at the break of day. Start again, I heard them say. Don't dwell on what has passed away, or what has yet to be. Again, the holy dove, she will be caught again, bought and sold and bought again. The dove is never free. That's how the light gets in. We asked for signs. The signs were sent. The birth betrayed. The marriage spent. Yeah, the widowhood of every government. Signs for all to see. I can't run no more with that lawless crowd. While the killers in high places say their prayers aloud, but they've summoned up a thundercloud. They're going to hear from me. That's how the light gets in. You can add up the parts. You won't have the sum. You can strike up the march. There is no drum. Every heart to love will come, but like a refugee. That's how the light gets in.
May God be with you. Good evening and welcome back, Wednesday folks. We are glad to be joining together in this pattern of weekly worship, still trying to worship safely during the middle of a pandemic. And I'm just going to recite the words of the song that we just heard by songwriter and poet Leonard Cohen. Ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. And that is going to provide a window into this church season of Epiphany. Epiphany means revelation. It's a season of illumination. And we are asking each one of us to dwell at this intersection between the world's deep brokenness and this hope of God that nothing can extinguish. Certainly we know the world's deep brokenness, the events of the past week, national turmoil and violence and distress, on top of a nation that is already so deeply divided. We will certainly be praying for that, but we know that brokenness, and so we gather in the hope of God's deep healing. And one cool thing about Epiphany, it's not just gonna be me and Pastor Beth doing the reflecting, it's gonna be ordinary members of Mount Olivet. Everyone has a story, everyone can point to the places where God is showing up in their lives. And so we'll begin this evening with Becky Kennedy. But first, let us pray together. God of heaven and earth, we live among the shattered pieces, the ripped hopes, and the broken trust. Meet us here. Come close with forgiveness and a call to love so we can rebuild. Help us see light shining through the cracks. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll now hear a video recording of Mount Olivet member Becky Kennedy reflecting on where she is experiencing brokenness and where she is finding hope.
Good morning. I'm Becky Kennedy, a member of Mount Olivet. When I think about this past year, I think that the worst time for me was in the early spring. I live by myself and I'm retired. So when the rest of the world shut down, I was really alone. There was nobody to talk to unless I would reach out on the telephone or something. There was a lot to be afraid of. Things were so scary on the news. I was afraid for my family. I've got four kids who are adults, but 10 grandkids ranging in age from 2 to 18. And most of all, I was afraid for my mother, who was 86. And that isolation all the time just made everything harder to bear. So when I prayed on those nights when I'd go to bed, my prayers were actually pleas more than prayer. And I would plead with God to please show up and be there in the world, to ease the suffering of those who were ill, gasping for breath and all by themselves. So my prayers were answered not by God making everything all right, but my being left with a feeling of calmness and peace and the sure knowledge that God was going to be with me through this no matter what happened. I began to see God and hear God, not in a burning bush experience and not on a mountaintop, but through people and places that I came into contact with, especially our online services, worship services when they started. Those were a lifesaver for me. And the church services that we've had this past year have been so meaningful to me. It seems like every scripture, every sermon, every song is something that's directed right to me, and it says exactly what I need to hear. God has also shown up in things like, in the middle of March, I had a birthday, and my 5-year-old granddaughter showed up delivering a birthday present. Now, the present was a special piece of her own artwork that she'd put in a special box But the real present for me was the fact she was just beaming. She was so happy and so excited to be able to give a gift. There was no way that I could not see God's light shining through that little girl. Another thing that happened that kind of blew me away was I usually go for a walk in the mornings, and right around the corner from my house is a pond. Well, one morning in the early spring, I was out on my walk and I heard this outrageous squawking coming from the pond. I walked around the corner and there were two swans. They were trumpeter swans. And the thing that amazed me was that I had never seen one before, but many years before, when my kids were young, I read them the book, The Trumpeter Swan, and it was one of our favorites. So I've thought about Ernest, the trumpeter swan, many times through the years, and there was just no way that you could tell me that that wasn't Ernest floating around on my pond. And I knew without a doubt that God had sent those swans to our pond so that my day could be brightened a little bit. I feel like at Mount Olivet, we're very lucky because we have so many chances to hear about God, to learn about ourselves, our pastors, other people in our congregation. I just am feeling really blessed to be here today. Thank you.
We're going to try that again. The gospel tonight is from Mark, the first chapter. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed in camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me, and I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice from heaven came, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. There is a time to tear and a time to sow. This line of poetry fits within a collection of verses from ancient wisdom literature about the seasons of our lives. We know it best if we hear it go like this: "For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven." Sounds familiar, doesn't it? I dusted off our worship planner, and we actually spoke these verses from Ecclesiastes on March 15th, 2020. It was the first Sunday of online worship and the stay-at-home orders. Those words, a gateway for us through a pandemic and all the social, political, and I know for you, the personal upheaval of these last 10 months. And hearing that reading, I've never spent much time thinking about tearing and sowing. In the Old Testament, the tearing has to do with ripping clothing in anger or repentance. And then sewing, of course, stitching something together to create something new. You sense then the repeated cycle from tear to sew and then back again. Yet after living through this last week, we can't so quickly move to sewing because we're traumatized by the tearing. It's no longer just for clothes as a sign of grief or confession. Tearing has become more violent and unpredictable and now extended to government buildings and our very own freedom itself. Even with 2021 fresh on the page, we have seen power and privilege tear and trample, and not subtly, but blatantly. One child interviewed after last Wednesday said so innocently as she watched the events, "I was just so scared they were going to come to my house." The events of this week have torn at wounds from earlier this summer and wounds from hundreds of years in this country. Lest we only focus on placing blame on other people, we look in the mirror, and as white people, we cannot deny what happens when human power is hoarded as an individual privilege rather than a communal gift. There is so much tearing right now. So the appointed scripture for this week is Jesus' baptism in the Gospel of Mark. Mark is a short gospel, and there aren't many words in Mark's story, so each one must be examined. This is Jesus' inauguration of sorts. From this point on, Jesus moves forward to impact and save the world. And where he begins is far from the buildings or places of power. Jesus is out in the wilderness with a lot of other people who have been awakened by this cry of John to repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of sin. There was a call to lean back in faith into the waters of the Jordan River, to be cleansed, to repent, to take a new direction in their life. And so Mark writes, as Jesus was coming up from the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. Now in Mark's gospel, it's not a gentle tear, but an intentional rip made by God himself. The word tear, a violent one in the Greek language, tearing the firmament of heaven itself, breaking through the space between this world and the realms of heaven, where the barriers and layers of sin kept building up. As much as most tears can be stitched together, this rip of the heavens cannot be tidied up. The world is forever changed when God rips through, and so is God. God is now here coming up out of the very water of the Jordan River within the flesh and blood of this man, Jesus Christ. And yet, even as God punched a hole in the atmosphere of our world, the narrator in Mark's gospel tells us that only Jesus saw this happen. The rest of the world, oblivious that God was now on the move and ultimately the power of divine love was here, clashing with every other earthly power, not to win, but to save the world. And so Jesus' ministry begins on foot, tearing down established ways that separated people from each other and from God, and separated people from the abundance that God so generously offers. The world fought Jesus' attempts to reveal what healing and love could do, because loving another can clip our own wings of control. And we will hear again throughout this year the walk that Jesus made from the River Jordan to the cross, There it was that Jesus died, and when his last breath was exhaled, this violent, tearing word is written again. The curtain of the temple torn in two from the top to the bottom. There was a curtain or a veil that separated the Holy of Holies, the Ark of the Covenant where the Ten Commandments were kept, where God was thought to be, kept protected from the rest of the world, and now it was ripped through. Even in the darkest hour, the divine tears through the barrier to move out and among. One must wonder, in the position that the world is right now, if God wants to rip another hole to express anger and rage at what God sees. And maybe that's why our emotions are all pinging and colliding this week and year, because our hopes, our stamina, and our trust is torn. I think, Mount Olivet, we find ourselves at the River Jordan and somehow in line to lean back into the waters, to be cleansed and claim, for our sin to be drowned, and to hear again that God is in the midst. It's time to change directions. Of course, we're only baptized once, but constantly brought back to what that means. God tears through this world for us and for all people, never tiring of forgiving and calling us from the very place we are to witness to the divine love in the way that we speak and the way that we act, always teaching us to love for the sake of another. We begin this year in that hope, and that's where we must stay, even though we are already exhausted on day 13. Movement and proximity will return to our lives as the vaccine is distributed in the months. And moving along, I trust we will see each other again face to face. And it seems more evident than ever that when we do, it's not only the comfort of being together, but the call of being together. To realize the treasure of each day and what lies within each of us, to act for the sake of mutual love. You may have seen the story of New Jersey Representative Andy Kim. Pastor Joel shared it with me, who at 1 a.m. last Thursday morning watched police officers collecting trash from the Capitol floor. He began to join in, he said, because he had to do something. It was on the ground work, far below the requirements of his job or the rotundas far above. But Representative Kim simply said, when you see something you love, you want to fix it. This epiphany, we speak of the brokenness, the cracks and the crevices, the tears and the rips. And we also speak that in that brokenness, there will be light that we are both called to notice and a light we're called to shine. And that is where the divine, who loves so much, enters and cannot stay away, with a love that will illuminate ahead, working in every action and word for a world that God loves so much. Just like Leonard Cohen sings, as Pastor Joel says, ring the bell that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light comes in. May it be so. Amen.
Each week we share a story of how the light gets in our church life and something that we're grateful for. Christmas already feels like it was a lifetime ago, but we wanted to follow up and tell you the story of your generosity as a congregation. We partnered with Home Free, the shelter for women and their children fleeing domestic violence. We partnered with PRISM, the Food, Shelf, and Social Service Agency, with Parenting with Purpose that helps out children whose parents are incarcerated, with Trinity Lutheran Church in the Cedar Riverside neighborhood, and with families in this congregation and wider community who simply stand in need. And we partnered with each one of them to provide gifts so that families could experience the joy of getting to give things to each other. Just wanted to share some totals. Because of your generosity, we were able to give 100 gifts and pajamas and socks to Home Free, the shelter, 300 plus toys to PRISM, and 200 gift cards for $25 each, a total of upwards of $5,000 to families through Parenting with Purpose and Trinity Lutheran Congregation and families in this own church and wider community. So that they, the parents in those families, would be empowered to buy gifts that they knew their kids would love this Christmas. We're so glad that we can be there and we can be available to people who need us when we ask. And just like Pastor Beth shared in her sermon, when we see something that we love, we want to fix it. And we love this community and we love this world. And we're grateful for the small actions and the large actions that you are taking to fix it. So now we will take an offering. You have an opportunity to share generously with this church. We'll give you a variety of ways to do so. And we'll also, if you're watching on Facebook, please be sure to share the comments in or share peace in the comments after I invite you to, as the band leads us in song. The peace of God be with you all. Share a sign of peace.
You called me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. Find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves, and oceans rise, but so the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me when my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me when my trust is without borders. Let me walk. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
You are, or where you are joining from, this is God's table, and there is a place for you here. Use whatever food and drink you have in your home, and know that if you do not share communion with us today, God's mercy still comes to you. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We pray together using the words Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The heavens tear open, and God's love is made known, and the earth is never the same. This bread is not the heavens, but it too is torn open, and God is made present, and you are never the same. Eat this bread and dwell in the hope that comes with the promise of God's presence with you in all things. The body of Christ is given for you. The blood of Christ is shed for you.
And I know that light shines down on me, and I know that the light shines down, and I know that light.
smiles down on me. And I know that the light shines down.
The presence of Jesus strengthen you and keep you in God's grace, now and forever. Amen. We enter into a time of prayer, and I'm happy to take your prayer requests in the comments, so you can start typing those now. I will begin, and I will be praying for our nation. So let us pray. God, we pray for our nation in its distress in these days. God, we pray for all who were injured in the attack on our nation's capital last week. We pray for the family of all those who were killed. We pray for all those who were attacked and faced fear, for members of Congress, for the Vice President, for their staff. We pray for those who did their best to protect, police and National Guard and military. God, we also pray for our whole nation, for all who fear for the future, for all who long for leadership, for all who grieve the division and violence between us. We pray, O God, for how this attack reveals other inequities in our land. We pause and wonder, but not for too long, how the response might have looked different if the majority of protesters had a darker skin color or if they were Muslim. God, we can no longer pray for a peaceful transition of power, but we do pray for peace in our national life. And God, we pray for truth to prevail, for the grip of conspiracy and deliberate misinformation to end. And finally, God, we pray for accountability, for all who will figure out what is next for us, for Congress and others as they continue the work ahead, for this deep and hard work of healing, for healing that does not brush harm done under the rug, but figures out how to balance it with justice. God, we pray for our president. We pray that he may lead. We pray that he may model what it looks like to take responsibility. God, we pray for the president-elect, for all that he will inherit, for the division in our nation. And God, we pray for each one of us, that we might know that we have a role to play in this process, that we don't wait for others to act, but that we step up in our own spheres and figure out with humility and also boldness what it means to speak peace, what it means to seek unity, what it is to love our neighbor and our nation in this moment. God, watch over us and protect us. God, in your mercy. I'm not seeing any prayers in the comments, but I will wait. And if you have a prayer, please submit it. If not, know that God holds those prayers in our hearts, even if they are not fully formed, even if they haven't found the words yet. Linnea, thank you. Yes, we're praying for mental health for teachers and students and all people, and helpful and comforting relationships to help them along. A lot of things can lead to mental health. One of the most important things is a network of support and supportive relationships, and that if we are in need of those, that God would send them to us. And if we have good mental health, especially an abundance of it, then that we would be sent to those who need our support. God, in your mercy. Angela, for foster parents and the challenges they face, God, for this call of love that is so difficult and complicated to step in and love a child fully, but also for the family of origin and the birth family, and for all the complications that there are, continue to send strength and healing to foster parents everywhere. God, in your mercy. Tracy, for teachers and students as they prepare to return to in-person learning, yes, we're going through a big change right now. We had the beginning of a school year in September. We're having another one in January. There's lots moving and lots shaking. So teachers and students and parents all need our prayers and need your presence, oh God. Accompany them through this transition. God, in your mercy. Taryn, another prayer for schools opening up, and in the addition to keep everyone healthy, God, send your spirit of wisdom help us to figure out what it means to live together with this disease in our midst. God, in your mercy. Marilyn, I'm so glad you're joining us this evening. Prayers and cards following your back surgery last Friday, recovering slowly. God, for this gift of healing that you are giving to Marilyn, we pray for the relief of her pain and for this community that supports her and surrounds her and lifts her up to God. God, in your mercy. Into your hands, O God, we pray, trusting in your mercy that you hear us and you respond. Amen.
It is good to be back. We hope you had a wonderful break, a restful break, a little bit of recalibration, right? Getting back into the swing of things. But Wednesday nights are for coming as you are and just leaning back. 2 days down, 2 days to go. And we're glad we can do that as a community. So this Epiphany theme, that's how the light comes in. Just be mindful. I think we have to do this every day, right? What's broken, and then where's the hope there? And so I invite you to do that as a daily practice. As you heard from Becky tonight, next week will be Sarah Cole, who will join us for her faith talk, and we'll have scriptures that connect with us together. But a really a guiding image for us in these dark days of winter and these dark days of pandemic and unrest to keep looking for the where the light is coming in. And then I want to point out, we are having conversations to keep this race equity conversation going on Sundays with our community partners. So these are organizations like Meals on Wheels and Habitat for Humanity. And we have conversations right at 11 o'clock with a leader from those organizations and leaders here talking about how they are engaging with race and what we can do together. I think the most important thing we can keep doing is pushing ourselves for awareness and learning and talking about these things. And I attended on Sunday and I learned things I didn't know, and I was able to hear perspectives that were so helpful. So Joel will pin that in the comments on where you can register to get the Zoom link for that, and we look forward to seeing you if that works for you as well. And then our safe gathering plan, you received an email from me yesterday, a constant contact message. We have worked hard to look ahead with hope and base our reopening or our safe gathering based on the Hennepin County 14-day case number rates. And so as cases decrease, we look toward those next steps. So that email had a lot of information. It's out on our website, and this is what I promise you, that we will be transparent in our communication as those shifts happen and communicate with you and answer questions. We do have two sessions set up. One is on next Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, and the subsequent one specifically for small group leaders and parents is on Sunday the 24th at 7:30. We just want to talk about what this is going to look like, what you can expect in church and the change, and leading through this together. So as always, if you have questions, please reach out, but I hope that information was helpful with that. So I invite you now to receive this blessing as you go on your way. May God's love embrace you like a mother receiving her child. May God nourish and empower you to care for others. May God's healing put your brokenness to use, radiating hope and shining forth in a world in need. God the Creator strengthen you, Jesus the Beloved fill you, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter give you peace. Amen. Go in peace. Let the light get in. Thanks be to God.
It's lost something kind of crucial.
You've got to stay bright to be the light of the world.
You are the salt of the earth.
You are the salt of the earth.
But if that salt has lost its flavor, it ain't got much in its favor.
You can't have the fault and be the salt of the earth. So let your light so shine before men.
It's kind of hard to hide it well.
You've got to stay pretty in the city of God. So let your light so shine before men. Let your light so shine. So that they might know some kindness again. We all need up to feel fine.
You are the light of the world.
You are the
stick. Ain't much good without a wick.
You've got to live right.